Good
morning, everyone. This is another of our series of trying to provide everybody who want to pass the driving exam with the tools and the road safety intelligence that they need to do so. We have to ensure that this occurs because we want everybody to pass the test. But today we're going to speak about the commercial vehicle. So those of you who want to pass the commercial vehicle exam, like persons who want to drive buses and trucks, yes, you need to watch this presentation. Yes, man, you need to watch it. All right, so this is part 6 of passing the driving exam. That would have mean that we have 5 parts before, right? So you need to watch. If you want to pass the driving exam, you need to watch all 6 of them. Yes, all 6 of them, right? So whether you drive a car or you're driving a bus or a truck, you need to know these things. Yes, man, you need to know, right? So let us move along. Well, you know, we are the road safety unit, and since July 1st, we have made a determined, calculated decision to put out messages here of empowerment, right? My name is Ken Uthier, Director of Road Safety Unit. I've been involved in road safety for about 20 years. It has been a very interesting journey. We work with it nonetheless. Not that we choose to work in the road safety unit and to do road safety work, but we do, since we're doing it, we're going to fulfill divine destiny, right? So, gentle people, work with us. Now, traffic crashes occur. By now, everyone who watched this presentation should know how traffic crashes occur, right? And by virtue of that, they should change their behavior. Now, before we go into the prayer, we have to pray. Father, we thank you for this morning, this day, the second day of the 10th month, 2020. This is a year of plenty, plenty. So we decree, we declare, Almighty God, this is the month of proving, this is the month of testing. Help us, O Lord, as we deliver our road safety message out there, as we deliver these presentations, and may these presentations touch the soul and the spirit of everyone listening in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father God, we have lost over 220 people as a result of traffic crashes. But Father God, we ask of you to ensure that this message spread wide and clear, so that, and far and wide, so that people know what to do out there, and may it influence their behavior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yes, man, we have to pray here. And all of you who are listening should pray every morning. When you wake up and give thanks to the Most High, right? Now, gentle people, traffic crashes occur because of a breakdown in the human, the environment, and the mechanical, right? That's all it takes for a traffic crash to occur. Now, gentle people, it is imperative that we make that deliberate, calculated decision to keep ourselves safe. One other thing we need to do, we need to preserve our lives. We need to want to live. We need to keep ourselves. And I must say, I would like, before we go deeper, I'd like to express our sympathy to the families across Jamaica who have to be dealing with COVID-19 deaths, and also persons who have committed suicide, right? I just want to say to people that I could have been a suicide victim. I planned my own suicide 1988. I planned it. Yeah, man, I planned it. Right? But I must say it was my aunt who stopped it. Right? So I would like to encourage persons to watch their children, listen to their children. Do not curse your children. Don't do it. Don't do it. You cannot curse your seed here. You cannot curse your seed. You can't do it. It don't make no sense. It's your child. Bless your child. The mouth that you have, Use it to do blessing. Bless your children. Pray for your children. Cover your children with the blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I just want to say that, right? I just want to say that. Because Road Safe say watch everything going on, you know. Because we want every child to be safe. We want every family member to be safe. So if there are children out there who feel like committing suicide, talk to a family member who you can trust and who can help you and who can empower you. Because when 1988, when I was on that road to take my life, right? It was only my aunt I told. She was the only person I told, right? And I must say, she played a part in me being alive. You know, I always tell people that I respect my auntie. Bad. I respect her. I honor her. Yeah, man. Gentle people, road safety, see, is on a three-legged stool. And I want everybody to get this. You see, if you watch our presentation, you're going to see this inside of it. I want you to get it. We want you to get it. Right? We don't want you to take it for granted. Now, human behavior is at the root of most of our traffic crashes. Right? We can see the pathetic, negative behaviors executed by motorists out there. Everybody can identify with them. Right? More time I am on the road, you know, especially on the, like when I'm in the country area, right? You find that drivers decide the road straight and nice, the driver decide to be to the out and bad. Everybody know what out and bad means. So they overtake, yes, and the white lines don't mean anything to them, right? I've had video, somebody sent me a video, you see, of a driver. The behavior was so bad, right? I cannot share the video with anybody because a lot of bad words are in the video, right? But what I would say, you see, those of us who love the bad behavior, we must know, you see, one thing we must know. You see, in the book of Galatians chapter 6, yeah, man, it's any seed we sow, we're going to reap it, you know. Yeah, man, in the seed so we'll reap it. So I would say to people who love to drive bad on the road, please to stop it, cut out that bad seed you're sowing of bad driving. It's not a good seed. And you don't want, let me tell you something, you don't want to reap from that bad seed here, because that bad seed that caused over 300 odd people to die in this country so far. It's that bad seed that caused over a million persons to die across the globe. It's that bad seed. Over a million people dead across the world due to traffic accidents already, you know. Know that, people. Know that. Right? So human beings, we have to shape up. And we shouldn't need a police officer over our back for us to do the right thing. I'm going to touch on an issue, you see, that I believe is affecting our road network. Look here, you need to be disciplined from your house, you hear? You need to discipline from your house, right? You need to get back to morals, you need to get back to values, and you need to be respectful of law and order out there. You need to stop promoting discipline in the house. You need to stop it. You need to stop it. And if you have a friend, anybody, can you see my friend them know, you know, that if you love negativity, you know, and you love disrespect, law and order, you know. You know, so that friendship, they cut off, you know. Because I go and wash me and clean, I feel like, oh, Pilate washes the hand of Jesus Christ, you know. I go and do it. We need to shape up, man. What is going to take you to understand, say, we need to take road safety serious, and we need to drive properly on the road. Look here, nowhere where you're going is important for you to go kill off yourself, here. Yeah? Nowhere is important for you to kill off yourself on the network. You have some family members who want to see you come home. Weekends are the most deadly period in this country. Weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Right? So we have to shape up and we have to make a decision to live. We have some loved ones who care about us. So why not care about them? We have to cut out this selfishness and this humanistic behavior that we have. We need to sow proper seeds, seeds of love, harmony, patience as we drive on a network. And those of you who are transporting people and only see the people them as $100 bill, you need to stop it. And people, look here, whomever is transporting you, if they only value you as a $100 bill, come out of their vehicles. Hello. Because if you continue driving them, you know, they will send you to Midaris. They will send you to Midaris before your time. They will send you to Dovecot before your time. They will send you to Dallas before your time. They will send you to Boog before your time. They may send you to number 570 before your time. They may send you to Maypen Cemetery before your time. Hello. Listen to me, man. The first law of man is preservation of life. You have your children and your family to live for. Don't make no shutter driver, no hot-head driver, no hot-foot driver send it to your grave before your time. Go read Psalm chapter 90 and you will know how much time you have to live. Come on. Read Psalm 90. Tell you. The other thing that contributes to traffic crashes is environment. Climatic condition contribute to it because when we are, you see, and this is why, you know, the person who trained to drive, you see, we have over 20 plus video on our scene, you see. If you have a driver's license right now, as a matter of fact, whether or not you have driver's license or not, go on the Road Safety Unit YouTube channel and watch all our videos. We have over 20 of them. And I can assure you, we still have more topics to cover, you know. But I can assure you that, you see those 20 odd videos? If you watch them and let the information come into your soul and your spirit, you'll be a better driver. You'll be a better road user. Yeah, man, you'll be a better road user. You won't be a slack road user. You won't be a road user who take people's lives and who give away your life. You won't be a road user who use your vehicle as a weapon of mass destruction. You won't be that type of road user. Hello. We have to shape up, man. We have to shape up. So hear this now. Your driving instructor is supposed to ensure you're driving in rain, you know. Yes, man, you're supposed to drive in a rain. And you're supposed to know that the speed limit, you see, for out there. It's for dry roads. Your driving instructor is supposed to tell you these things. So when you see the road wet, people, the speed limit is only for dry roads. So we have to cut down the speed. Because some of us, we have a crash last month, you know. That happened. Up to now, I'm vexed about it. I'm vexed because man say road wet. Man has speed. Hydroplane and then go and press brake. Recipe for disaster. Go and watch our tire safety intelligence video. Also watch our wet roads video. Yeah, man. With the two videos on wet roads, two presentations on wet roads. Go watch them. Go watch them. Because we're keeping it real, you know. We're keeping it real because the 320 people who have been killed, they are real people and we have to try to prevent it. We have to try to prevent it. We know what data is saying that we could have over 400 dying this year, but we need as a people to get in our subconscious that in our mind, our body, our soul, and our spirit, man, we're not going to die. All of us in the country have to do it. The over 3 million that are here, we have to do it. We have to do it, man. We have to do it. We have to want to live. We have to want to live because we have some family members who love us. The other thing that, the other environmental part that affect it is the road now, the road. Now hear me now. Two components of the road. Can we look at the road? You have to look at the two sides. So one side we look at the good side. Yeah, man, the good side. So you see when the road have adequate road markings, adequate road signs, and it have edge lines, and it is nicely laid. Carpet, nicely laid carpet. Yes, man, nicely laid. We call it carpet. Yeah, man, nicely laid. You know what some of us do? We use that road to execute some driving that is nefarious and precarious. Yeah, man. and we need to stop it. I have seen in the black box a vehicle crash, you see, up to 180 kilometers per hour. And I said, no, I expect people to die. Mm-hmm. People won't die. That's too much energy coming on the human body to break up internal organs. So the good roads people, obey the speed limit, obey the road sign, obey the road marking. I know you say that a lot of you hear this over and over. But the reason why we have to say it over and over is because people are not obeying. And because, you see, when people don't obey, you feel it. Granny is right, you know. Granny say, who cannot hear, feel. And a lot of people have felt it. And they have caused people to feel. Right? They have caused people to mash up. They have caused people to die. Right? I have a video I went play with a young miss. May her soul rest in peace. Falasha Fitz Henley. When I see what a motor vehicle did to that lady, that motivated me to go harder. She was a road safety warrior. She was committed to road safety. And it's a motor vehicle driver rob her. Rob us of her. Rob her family members of her. The next thing is that bad roads, you see? Bad roads also cause crashes too. Yeah, man. Patrol infested roads. Drivers swing from patrol and swing into other people's vehicle and crash and mash up other people's vehicle. Bad roads mash up your vehicle. Bad roads cause increase your vehicle operating costs. So we don't like bad roads. We don't like it. Because bad roads are not safe. Those of you who watch our mitigating traffic crashes series would have recognized that the United Nations said that we must have safer roads and mobility, safer roads and roadsides. And this is what we're striving for, but we need the active parts with everybody. So you see those roads that you consider to be problematic and bad and not in good condition, you can email the road safety unit. You can email us. Your email address is in the presentation. So it's there. You can email us. Feel free to do so. So we have to work assiduously to ensure that the roads are in good condition. And when the roads are in good condition, we as road users need to maintain them and don't mash up the road. So we're supposed to be lighting a tire in the road and burning up the road. Hello. We're not supposed to be digging up the road and running illegal electricity under the road. Yeah, man, we're not supposed to do that. Gentle people, we have to do better, you know. We have to do better. After the better. The next component of the road safety two leg is the mechanical, the motor vehicle. We need to ensure our motor vehicle is in good condition. And yes, I am aware that the road, because the road bad, it mash up the front end and the back end. We know that. It happened to me too. It happened to myself too. It happened to me too. But we have to try to ensure that our vehicles are safe. And gentle people, when we know that the road, if we have to travel on patrol infested road, you see, and then take long to fix it, you see? What we have to do, we take time, go down at the hole them. Take time. So you will have some people behind you who go and blow you, especially some taxi driver. Me talk about what them do me. Me, don't pay them a mind. You take your time, because front end parts expensive. And if they curse you, just say, I cancel that curse in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I cancel that curse in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Yes, man, because words sound power. We are not fools. We know words sound power. Rasta tell us words sound power. We're not going to forget that. And in the books, it said death and life lies in the power of the tongue. So we know that. So we're not going to allow anyone to speak negatively about us. We're going to cancel that. So people cancel talking over your life. And you don't speak them over your life either. Forge no covenant, no contract, no agreement, no treaty with negative words. They are life. Word is life. Words sound power. So hear this now. Make sure your vehicle is in good condition. Wear your seatbelt. If you ride bike, wear helmet, wear elbow pad, wear all safety gadgets. Yes, man, wear them. They give you a fighting chance. And let me tell you something now. I will address that issue again. You see, when you see people trying to do something good, if you don't have anything good to say, shut your mouth. Yeah, man, shut your mouth. Why I say this? We were in Peter's Field on Sunday, September 20, and it hurt me to the core, man. It hurt me to the core. People commit their mind, their body, their soul, and their spirit to educate motorcyclists across this country. And one motorcyclist decided to curse what's going on. Says foolishness. The good thing about it is that the other 40-odd motorcyclists never think that way. But the sad thing about it is that when it was said, I'm sorry, the people who heard never tell me. Because I would have found that motorcyclist, you know. Yeah, man, and try to talk some sense in his head. You know what hurt me? When I go back September 27th, me hear all of this story. Hear same dead. Hear same crash. The same thing on my top boat. Stop ride on white lines. Same thing on my top boat. Motorcyclists in Western Jamaica have a nasty habit of riding on the white line of the road. And when them ride on the white line, yeah, them have head-on collision with other bike. Brethren, the man ride on the white line. Man ride on the white line and end up dead. And bring trauma and sorrow to him family. Brethren, who want the dead to stop on the road, man? Who want the dead to stop on the road? So you see, when it's the programs that are being put out to help you, or to help you as a category of road user, the best thing you can do is pray for the people who are execute the program, because they have to give up something to come to you. When a man give up him weekends to come to you, right? Appreciate it, man. Don't curse the people I do. Don't do it. Don't do it. If you can't use your mouth to bless, shut your mouth. Okay. All right. We have a video to play. Yeah, man, watch it. Drink people. It's very serious. Very, very serious. Very serious. Right? Very serious. So it's important for us to remember that when traffic crashes occur, everybody hurts. Everybody hurts. There are no prizes. There are no prizes. Let me check this chat. Okay. All right. Thank you for the message. Thank you for the message. Yes, man. All right. So in the chat room, you feel free to put in question. But hear what now. Today's presentation is geared towards persons who are operating commercial motor vehicles. Right? So we just want especially trucks. More specifically, trucks. Now, one thing I would like to say is that whenever trucks are involved in collision, you see, the investigator must inspect the truck, right? And today we're going to speak about some of the parts that make up the truck, right? We're not going to go in depth into everything. We're just going to whet your appetite, right? Because we're going to come back with some more stuff. So we want you to just to know some parts. We're not going to talk about everything. But one critical thing you must understand about the truck is that the truck have a air brake system. And the reason why it have the air brake system, because when they look, they could not put in a hydraulic braking system there because it would wear out quite quickly. And based on the fact of the dynamics of how trucks are built, it wouldn't make no sense. Right? So hear this now. So when we, for the truck, it's very important that whomsoever is operating a truck, they're aware of the air brake system and all its components. In other words, you must know everything about it, right? So we have the air brake system, right? It's a total system. So we have the tractor, that's the head of the thing, and we have the trailer, that's the back part, right? Yes, trailer. Right? So we have different, and both of them are connected. Once you see, there's a connection going on. These trucks have different tanks, whether wet tank or dry tank, right? They have tank. They have all different types of valves operating there. We're going to go into some of these things. They have glad hands. They have fifth wheel. We're going to talk about it. They have slack adjusters. Yeah, they have push rods. Yes, man. They have reservoirs, right? So we're going to talk about, they have airbags. So we're going to talk about those things. They have brake drums, right? So we're going to talk about those things. We're going to show you some stuff. So this is what the air brake system of a truck, tractor trailer look like, right? Get familiar with it if you love trucks, right? And if you are not into trucks, right? There are some things we want you to see. Right, so you will know whether or not you can look at a truck, you know. You can look at a truck and know whether or not the air brake system is in good condition. You can just look and know. We'll show you that, right? So hear this now. We have the air brake system. Commercial vehicles use air brake system for the most part rather than a hydraulic system. The hydraulic system is a closed system, right? No need for a separate braking system, right? Truck tractor must be connected to trailer, whether single, doubles, or triples. Now, let me stop here. In Jamaica, we only have single trailers. We don't have doubles, we don't have triples, right? Triple trailers for the trucks. Now, what happened is that in other jurisdictions like North America and Europe, South America, you will see doubles and you will see triples. These require a certain dynamic. And also, these drivers who operate those doubles and triples, they are specially trained. Now, remember now, a bus, these buses you see out there, they sit on a truck chassis. So a bus is really a truck, right? Just as it's carrying passengers, still a commercial vehicle, right? However, one must understand that the task must be executed with relative ease so that we maintain the integrity of the braking system. So this air brake system, we have to ensure it's in top shape. Now, remember now, air and the hydraulic system are not friends. So what that mean? When you drive, if your car, for your car, the mechanic, you see, is doing everything to ensure that there is no air in the brake. So he will pump it out. He will bleed out the air out of it. Out of here. Because if air is in your hydraulic braking system, that will cause problem. Therefore, I mean that once the air is introduced, integrity of the braking efficiency will deteriorate. Right? So we have to understand that, right? So, gentle people, be aware of that, right? So there's a difference between the truck and the car. So remember, I tell you, we talk about some of the parts of the truck. You need to know it. Yeah, for this commercial vehicle. So what happens is that the bus, the truck, right, have a compressor. Yeah, man, it have a compressor. This is what the compressor look. So when you open the engine of a truck, you can look and you can see the compressor. So this is a compressor. So when you see this, this is a compressor. What is this? This compressor is the source of the energy for the air brake system. So if your compressor are bad enough, that means, gentle people, your air brake system in trouble, right? So when these crashes happen, we're going to check out if the compressor in good condition. We have to check these things, right? Because as I tell you before, when you are investigating a truck crash, you have to look at these things. Is the compressor working? You have to check if the driver will say they lose brake, you know, and nothing no go so. Nothing no go so because people find fault. Everybody involved in a crash want to get away, you know, they want to get away. All when they kill people and mash up people, they want to get away. But we are here for them. We're investigating. The air compressor is the workhorse of the air brake system. It's located in the engine compartment and is attached to the motor. It may be belt driven or gear driven, yeah. Belt or gear driven. Yeah, man. Some of them are self-lubricating, and it's the primary source of contamination in the air brake system. So yes, people, you say, yes, why this compressor is important? It's one of the primary source of contamination in the air brake system. So gentle people, hear this now. We have to ensure with the compressor in good condition. And those of you who are driving trucks out there, check the compressor. Make sure your compressor is in good condition. And make sure there are no contaminants. Yeah, man. Ensure that. We must understand that gear oil can be forced past the compression rings and end up in the air reservoir where it can then mix with any collected moisture. So very important that we know this. This is the compressor. And guess what? You have to know this for the exam. Because we're going to show you. We're going to have questions. You're going to have to identify different parts. Right? Of vehicles. Yeah, man. The compressor forms a gray, this may form a gray sludge that can then find its way into the air delivery lines, where it can then affect the many valves and service relay valves that control airflow to the brake chambers. Gentle people, listen to me. You see, driving a truck on the network, you know, that is why persons who drive trucks, you know, they need to be properly trained. They need to be properly trained. There's a reason why the North Americans have a 6 weeks program for persons to go through. You cannot operate a truck in North America without being properly trained. You need to know these things. And Europe, North America and Europe. That is why we are using the opportunity to provide this information on our side. We know that there are places that teach you how to drive truck. Go and learn to drive the truck and learn about all of these parts. And you're going to see why. You're going to see why. And those are you who buy trucks, you see, and operate trucks and give people to drive, you need to be careful who you give your vehicle to drive. You need to be careful who you give your vehicles to drive. It will mash up your vehicle and cost your money. Try and know that. So as a compressor performs work to compress the air, it is heated to a high temperature. Once this heated air is passed into the air reservoir, it is then introduced into an environment that has a much lower ambient temperature. Gentle people, this compressor here is a workhorse of the air brake system. It must be in good condition. Temperature changes cause the water molecule to condense and form moisture, people. Condensation then becomes another source of contamination to the air brake system. Remember, people, we don't want our air brake system to be contaminated. Improper maintenance and brake adjustments are the major causes of brake failure and reduced braking efficiency. So I want to understand, why is it that we're coming to you now with a presentation, passing the giant exam, and we're talking about these things? Based on intelligence, a lot of truck crashes are due to air brake system failure deficiency. Reduce braking efficiency and brake failure. Because the compressors have been contaminated. The air brake system have been contaminated. Gentle people, we need to know these things. And that's how we have to change how we operate now. We have to change it. Remember now, the compressors are designed to run whenever the engine is running. As a result, they are able to produce much more air than is needed for the brake system. To prevent the compressor from producing too much compressed air and to reduce the load on the engine, a governor is used in the air brake system. You hear that now? Listen to me now. We're going to learn some things, you know. I tell you, everything is connected. To prevent, remember now, the compressors are designed to run whenever the engine is running. They are able to produce much more air than that is needed by the braking system. So what happened now is that a governor is placed in the system to govern the flow of air. Yeah, man. When the air pressure is high enough in the system, the governor causes the compressor to stop pumping air out. So you have a cutout. Yeah, man. So you have cutout. So know that cutout is when the air pressure is high enough in the system. So the governor going to cause the compressor to stop pumping air out, right? So just remember that, stop pumping air, go and do that. So just know the governor govern the thing. Just like how you have governors, yes man, governor in the truck. There's a component in the air, the system, in the engine named governor, know what its purpose is. When the air pressure system drops to a certain point, the governor will cause the compressor to start pumping air again. Yes man. So remember now, that is cut in. So cut out is when the governor will cause the compressor to stop pumping air. No, and that is when the air pressure is too high. When the air pressure drops to a certain point, the governor cut in. And then now, start to pump back air again. People, we need to know these things. You're operating a truck, you must know these things. Yeah, man. The truck is not just alone pushing gear stick and then steering. You need to know these things because you need to know as a truck. Because you see, truck drivers are known as professional drivers, you know. They're not driving a car, right? They have to be specially trained. You have to be specially trained to operate a truck. If not, you won't mash the truck. Now, a vehicle should only be driven when the air pressure is in the normal operating range. There's a normal operating range. Any drop in air pressure below the normal cutting setting is a sign that the air brake system is malfunctioning or that an abnormal demand is now being placed on the system. Try bring the vehicle to a safe stop as soon as possible. only proceed when the air pressure returns to its normal operating range. And all other operating air brake system functions are normal. So you have to wash your dashboard. Yeah, man, you have to watch it. Compressed air is a form of stored energy, and that can be hazardous. Air compressor compress air by forcing it into a smaller space. These air compressors are powered directly by the engine. As I tell you before, they use belts or pulleys or gears. Air compressors are mounted directly on the engine or by brackets and fasteners. The governor controls the air compressor cutting and cutout pressure. Yes, I told you that earlier. The operating pressure air range for a vehicle air brake system must be between 552 kilopascals or 932 kilopascals or 80 psi's or 135 psi. It is, let me say, so you know this range. This is the range. The air pressure must be in, right? So you have to check these things. Check these things, people. Check these things. The operating pressure range. Yes, man. Know these things. It is unsafe to drive a vehicle when the air pressure is outside of the normal operating range. So it's beyond, if it's outside the 80 to 135 PSI, you know that we have to check out what's going on.
I saw people,
this thing is serious. We're still on the compressor. Remember, I tell you the compressor is the workhorse of the vehicle. Compressed air is stored in the vehicle supply or wet tank. And the dual service, that is primary and secondary air tank. To prevent too much moisture and air from collecting, the air tanks must be drained regularly. Now, different companies have different operations, so they may allow the driver to do it, or they may have specific mechanics who will do that. So it depends on the standard operating procedure of the company, but these tanks must be drained so that the moisture and oil is released, because you don't want you don't want the tanks to be contaminated. Air pressure gauges indicate air pressure in the vehicle's primary and secondary air tanks. We need to recognize that the safety valves prevent air overpressure of the air brake system. Low air pressure warning devices give drivers a visual and sometimes audible warning that air pressure is dangerously low. Now, yes, they have air dryers. The trucks have air dryers. So much in the trucks have. So we have to ensure the air brake system are working. The air dryer removes moisture from the air brake system and expel it when the compressor reaches cutout pressure. So remember now, the governor will control, would operate with a cutout. So cutout, too much pressure, so the governor take over, compressor down. When the pressure is low, the governor going kick in and we have cut in, right? So just remember that. So what happens at times is that there's an alcohol evaporator that adds alcohol vapor to the air brake system to help prevent moisture in the system, and especially from freezing. So you find that in cold countries, this is used a lot, right? Let us move along. Our next component of the truck is the air reservoirs. The air reservoirs. So this is the storage tank for the volume of compressed air needed to operate the air brake system. The manufacturer will determine the size of the reservoir and the volume of compressed air needed to ensure the proper functioning of the air brake system. Please be advised that the reservoir is not the only thing used in the air brake system. However, it assists in reducing the time needed to activate the brakes upon application. Reservoir, this is it, air reservoir. Checking the system for contaminants is extremely important in determining the overall efficiency of the braking system. Reduce air volume in the air reservoir may reduce the amount of air application pressure in the air delivery lines. It can affect the amount of brake force being generated at the brake points by reducing air pressure to the brake chamber. Now, when we talk about brake chambers, right? It's important for us to know this. When air leaves these supply tanks, it splits into two circuits, passing into primary and secondary air tanks called dual service tanks. These are called dry tanks because they collect less moisture than the supply or wet tank. Having two delivery circuits is a safety feature that ensures if one circuit fails, the other circuit will provide enough brake function to start the vehicle. These two circuits are referred to as primary circuit and secondary circuit. When air flows out of the supply tank, it is prevented from returning by one-way check valves. When draining the tanks, the supply tank should always be first to prevent accumulated moisture flowing into the next tank that's been drained. When the supply tank is drained first, any accumulated moisture is removed before it passes further into the system. Always remember to drain the supply tank first, gentle people. First tank that compressed air enters is called the supply tank. Since it collects most of the moisture and oil that drop out of the air, it is also called a wet tank. If the mixture of moisture and oil that collects into the supply tank passes into the rest of the air brake system, it can damage brake components and interfere with the operations of the system. Gentle people, you see why it's important for you to drain your tanks? I hope you understand that. Can damage your brake components and interfere with operational system. And these things can be very costly, people. These are some of the problems that can occur. The collected moisture and oil mixture can form a sludge that can pass from the tank into another component, into other components of the air brake system, damaging seals and causes brake valves to stick. The mixture of oil and moisture can become corrosive and damage the air tank and other system components. And this basically will cost you money. Moisture in the brake system can freeze in cold temperatures and may cause brake failure. Too much moisture and oil collecting in the air tank can reduce the volume of air and may cause brake failure. People, be aware of that. Contaminants can affect the many valves and fittings present in the system by preventing air from passing into the air delivery lines. So this graphical representation is showing sludge, oil, and moisture, right? We need to get it out of the tank. We have to get it out. Drivers should drain the reservoir at the start of each workday while conducting the pre-trip inspection, or if companies may have a standard operating procedure that somebody has to, it must be done. The tank must be drained of contaminants, people. Because if you don't drain it, you will damage the earbrake system, and that is money, unnecessary money. So just do the right thing, do the right thing. This is done through the ear tank drain valve located at the bottom of each tank. See them here? You look at the tank. Yeah, familiarize yourself with the thing. Remember to check each tank to be sure it's fully drained. And also, watch for anything abnormal about the discharge from the tank. Yes, man. Gentle people, when you drain these tanks, look at the discharge from the tank. What is coming out? Yes, man. Yes. So we're moving to the governor now. Yes, man. Because remember, the governor governs things. The governor play a role in cutting out and cutting in. So the pressure too high. The governor, the compressor put out too much air pressure. The governor going to come in and say, no, man, you have to stop now, man. You have to stop. Governor control. When it's too low, the governor say, yes, man, I have to come in. I have to come up. So you have cut in and you have cut out. So to prevent the compressor from producing too much compressed air and reduce the load of the on the engine, a governor is used in the air brake system. A governor, people, governor. When the air pressure is high enough in the system, the governor causes the compressor to stop pumping air. When the air pressure drops to a certain point, the governor will cause the compressor to start pumping air again. Yes, man. The governor operates in conjunction with air pressure and loading mechanism and maintain reservoir air pressure between a predetermined maximum and minimum valve. Know that, people. It's located between the supply reservoir and the air compressor. Cutting pressure varies for trucks between 100 to 130 psi. Audible, listen, people, listen to this part. So drivers, listen to this. Audible, visible warning signal to the driver when air pressure reaches 55 psi. Drivers must pay attention to the signal. Hello? Pay attention to the symbol and the signal. Because it's going to come if the air pressure is too low. You're going to get a message. So, gentle people, work with the program. So we have air dryer now. We talk about air dryer. Yes, man, air dryer. This is an inline filtration system whose primary function is to remove any liquid or water vapor from the compressor discharge air so that only clean, dry air is supplied to the brake system. Jesus, please. This is why this is important. Air dryer important. So we have to make sure that our air dryer is in good condition to maintain it. Because remember, you know, if we don't maintain these things, it can affect the air brake system. It can affect the truck to start. So a lot of times you see trucks crash and run off a road. Sometimes you see, you find the trucks are run off that road name, North South Highway, and going at the roundabout and take out the roundabout. Sometimes, you know, is either the driver cannot drive, the driver disobedient because up the top of the road it say, go in low gear. And him saying it's a big driver. Him no need for operate because you're going downhill. So I don't need to go in downhill. I don't need to go in a low gear. No, man. Disobedient. And then they go down the road, they're in trouble. Or the air brake system is contaminated. Now, next thing. Poor maintenance of the filtration system will cause problems filtering out contaminants whose presence will reduce available air pressure to the brakes. And remember that this vehicle is an air brake system vehicle. The air dryer is located near the air compressor and is sometimes attached to the rear of the cab of the truck tractor. Know that. This is what air dryer look like. Air dryer is located between the air compressor and the supply tank. Air that is pumped by the compressor pass through the air dryer where it cools and passes through a drying material. This removes moisture from the air before it reaches the supply tank. Moisture collecting the air dryer is expelled with high pressure air when the compressor reaches cutout pressure. I've been speaking about cutting and cutout a lot. Air dryer is easily accessible and can be easily changed. Filtering air before it reaches the air reservoirs will assist in preventing freeze-up of the air delivery line, especially during winter. We wouldn't have this problem here because we don't have winter. But those of you who are driving in winter country would know about this. Vehicles using air dryers must still have their air tanks drained regularly. So not because you have the air dryer, you're going to say, I'm not going to drain the tank. No, you need to drain the tanks. You need to drain the tanks. Yeah. Now, this is something very important now. So apart from checking the inspecting the vehicle, checking the truck, air brake system, we have to understand, and you see, this is something that all drivers should know. There's something known as mechanical lag time. This is the time that expires when first brake application to the activation of the foundation brakes, right? So there's a time. So this shows that it takes between 0.25 to 0.5 seconds. Therefore, a tractor trailer is traveling at 55 kilometers per hour. When the driver detects an object in the path of the vehicle, the driver attempts to avoid a collision with the object by making a full emergency appeal. How far does the vehicle continue to travel at a constant velocity if the perception reaction time is 1.5 seconds? We can work it out. Right? When we work it out, because we're doing it in meters, we know the perception reaction time is 1.5, right? We know how far the vehicle would have traveled, right? 15.28 meters per second. We know the brake lock time is between 0.25 and 0.5 seconds. So since this vehicle is traveling at constant velocity at 55 kilometers per hour, we then know that the vehicle would travel between 26.74 meters and 30.56 meters before the brakes are activated and vehicles start to decelerate. What are we doing here? We are calculating things how we need to know so that when we are investigating, analyzing these collisions, we know exactly what's happening, right? So check that, people. Be aware of that. Gentle people, this is what can happen to the trucks, right? This is what can happen to the trucks, right? Can happen to the trucks. Now, there's another part of the air brake system known as slack adjuster. Slack adjuster, right? Slack adjuster is a part of the air brake system that is used to adjust the brakes when needed. The slack adjuster is located on the air canister on the axle housing near the wheel. On vehicles with brake drum, it is between the push rod and the S-cam. We have to tell you what these, we have to show you what these things look like, right? The S-cam, right? It look like an S, right? On vehicles with this brake, it is between the push rod and the power screw. Slack adjuster, right? Slack adjuster, right? Brake chamber, right? Adjustable nut. Air brake system use compressed air to transmit pressure from the brake pedal to the brake pads. They are typically used in larger vehicles such as trucks and buses. All air brake system run the risk of moving out of adjustment over time, and that's why I have to check the mechanic. Out of adjustment brakes are most reported problem from roadside vehicle safety inspectors. So the Island Traffic Authority people would pick up a lot of these things, right? So you can't just look at the slack adjuster on the vehicle and just know, say, the brake system out of work, need adjustment. Out of adjustment brakes constitute a safety hazard, as vehicles with excessive brake slack can be difficult to stop. Hello, I tell you already that some of these trucks that are involved in collisions, I have seen the slack adjusters not where they're supposed to be. Not where they're supposed to be. This is what a slack adjuster look like. Yes. This is what a brake drum look like. This is the S cam. It look like a S, right? So the S cam, right? All right. Now, gentle people. All vehicles manufactured since 1994 have been built with automatic slack adjusters that adjust themselves during full brake application. Automatic slack adjuster, for the most part, should only require manual adjustment during installation. If a brake system with automatic slack adjuster require periodic adjustment, so this is what the slack adjuster look like. It should be about 90 degrees, yes? I've seen some at about 135 degrees, 140 degrees. So you know point blank that the driver won't have a lot of braking efficiency. Right. So if it requires period maintenance, it means that it's defective and it should be repaired. Whether or not you have automatic or manual slack adjuster, you should ensure that they get the regular maintenance checkup. You should check that. Whoa. I'm going to tell you something. I saw a truck some time ago. Right, and we were doing some tests on the truck. And we look at the back of the truck and then we say, no man, something look right. We notice only one slack adjuster around the truck and we notice that only one push rod. The driver, we asked the driver about the driver say, go in the truck and bring something, come and ask if this is the push rod. Trust me, people. We have to step up our inspection of these trucks that are out there and ensure that their braking efficiency is in alignment. What I have seen out there is cause for concern. It's just a matter of time before we're going to have more problems with trucks, right? So the maintenance of trucks, we need to maintain our trucks and make sure we have proper braking efficiency. So spring brakes now. So this is what the slack adjuster look like, right? This is slack adjuster. It's supposed to be always about 90 degrees. So the clevis pin hold it in here. The yoke is there, the push rod here. So it's coming. So it's, you press the brake, it come up. Anyway, let us not get into the technicalities of it. We just want you to know what it is because we're going to come with a presentation that is going to go into the technicalities of it. Right? I want you who are driving these vehicles to be aware of it. So first, it's principally about knowing what they are and how they work and the purpose. And we're going to come into the technicalities afterwards. All vehicles with air brakes must have a way of stopping it if the service brake fails. Most vehicle manufacturers combine this emergency braking system with a parking brake system using spring brakes. Spring brakes are not air applied like service brakes. They apply when air pressure leaves the brake chamber and release when air pressure builds up in the chamber. All right, so be aware of that. Spring brakes use a different type of brake chamber from service brake. A brake chamber that includes both service brake and spring brake section is called a spring brake chamber. Spring brake chambers apply the brakes by means of a large coil spring that provides enough force to hold the brakes in the applied position instead of using air to apply the brake. Spring brake chambers are different in appearance from service brake chambers. To accommodate the large coil spring, a section must be added to the service brake chamber that is clearly visible and adds significantly to its size. So that's why you'll see the spring brake chamber looking different from the normal one. No, here it is now. The spring brake chamber is piggybacked onto the system, onto the service brake section. And these two sections function as two separate chambers. The portion nearest the push rod, right, is a service brake section, and it works the same manner as a separately mounted service brake. To release the spring brakes, normally between 60 psi or 414 kilopascal of air pressure must be supplied to the spring brake chamber to compress or cage the system. If the system pressure is below 414 kilopascal or 60 psi, the spring brakes start applying because there is no longer enough pressure to keep them released. Many vehicles can still be driven even when the spring brakes apply because they do not have the braking power of the full service brake application. Before driving the vehicle, it's important to ensure that the air brake system has enough air pressure, normally about 60 psi, to keep the spring brakes from applying. Due to the way that most spring brake chambers are currently constructed, it's very difficult to unintentionally release the spring brakes. The large coil spring used in the spring brake chamber is compressed under very high tension. Tampering, damage, or corrosion can cause the spring to release, resulting in sudden violent motion of parts of the air brake chamber. Since this can be hazardous, never attempt to service or repair any air brake chamber. Hear that, people? No. Sliding tandems. Sliding tandems are used to distribute weight, remove the chuck, ensure you always lock the tandems. Right? Always. Sliding tandems in heavy vehicle refer to two closely placed axles, legally defined by distance, and both the US and the EU have their rules. And for the most part, we tend to follow them. Either or both axles may be powered and often interact with each other, right? Different jurisdictions have different rules governing how this thing should work. We have what is known as tractor protection valve. It protects the tractor air supply. That's a tractor air supply under trailer breakaway conditions or when a sudden air loss evacuates or when a sudden air loss evacuates the system. It will prevent complete loss of air to the truck tractor brakes and allow the driver to safely bring the vehicle to a complete stop on the shoulder of the highway or road before a complete loss of braking ability occurs. The valve is mounted at the rear of the cab and is operated in conjunction with a dash-mounted control valve. Quick release valve. The function of the quick release valve, this is what it looks like, is to speed up the exhaust of air from the air chambers once the foot treadle is released. It is mounted close to the chambers it serves. In its standard configuration, the valve is designed to deliver within 1 psi of control pressure to the control device. However, for special applications, the valve is available with greater differential or zero hysteresis. When a brake application is made, the air pressure enters the supply port, diaphragm moves down, sealing the exhaust. At the same time, the air pressure forces the edges of the diaphragm down the air flows. Down and air flows out of the delivery ports. When air pressure It's being delivered beneath the diaphragm. It's equal to the pressure being delivered by the break chamber that's above the diaphragm. The outer air diaphragm will seal against the body seat. So this is the diaphragm. Diaphragm. So the quick release valve is a very important valve, right? Playing a very important role, right? Because when the brake application is made, air pressure enters the supply port, the diaphragm moves down, sealing the exhaust. So we have to familiarize ourselves with these things. And that is why persons who are operating trucks need to be specially trained. And they will then know what is going on and how to ensure that the air brake system. And I must say, investigating a truck crash is very tedious.
Some people don't like it.
Some people don't like to investigate truck crash because of the technicalities design. And that is why you have specialized trained investigators who specialize in trucks. Quick release valve. We continue on the quick release valve. The exhaust port is still sealed by the center portion of the diaphragm when the supply air is released. The air pressure above the diaphragm is released back through the brake valve exhaust. Air pressure beneath the diaphragm forces the diaphragm to rise, opening the exhaust and allowing delivery air to leave, right? The air brake system also have what's known as a relay valve. The relay valve is used to balance the time of brake applications on heavy duty vehicles. They are especially needed when large volumes of air are required or long service lines cause the capacity of the brake valve to be exceeded. It is found on or near the drive axle brakes and trailer axle brakes and ensures simultaneous application of the front and rear brakes on the combination unit when an air brake application is made with the foot treadle. Get used to what these things look like. It's needed to speed up the brake application at these distant points in order to ensure that all the brakes are working in conjunction with each other to prevent braking imbalances from occurring. So rearmost drive axle to the last axle on the trailer is several times the distance the same air application travels to the front brakes. Serves as a quick release point. Once the air application is released, air escaping from the brake chambers must be prevented to the atmosphere. This may be done by returning the air to an exhaust port on the foot treadle or by venting the air into the atmosphere through the relay valve. Venting the air through the relay valve speeds up the release of the brakes and again ensure that a braking imbalance does not occur. So the relay valve, very important piece of the air brake system that we have to be cognizant of, and we have to ensure that we leverage. We have what is known as the air coupling device. So you'd have seen these devices at the back of the truck. You'll see different hoses. They are coupling devices. So you'll see the red one, you'll see the blue one, you'll see the green one, right? So these hoses, blue hose is a service line and it supply air to the service brake. Red hose is the emergency line and it supply air to the parking and emergency brake. Green hose is the electrical line. The hoses are coupled to the trailer with connectors called glad hands, right? So you will say glad hands, right? Glad hands must be checked as they can be a source of air loss to the air brake system. Rubber grommet wears out, right? So because of hard and become hardened with age, which allow airs to escape. So we need to check these rubbers, right? Critically, right? These air coupling devices, very important. It can cause the compressor to overwork. If air loss is sufficient, it could allow air to complete the vent from the spring brake chamber and activate the trailer spring brake. And you don't want that. Glad hands, therefore, are crucial to the air brake system. This is what the brake chamber look like. Converts the energy of the compressed air into the mechanical energy required for braking. Types of brake chambers, you have the clamp, you have the bolt, and you have the rotor chamber. Now we have another part of the system, leaf spring. This is it, right? Leaf spring. It's part of the steering system of a truck, right? Ensure your leaf spring are in good order. If they are broken, check your mechanic, right? Check them. It's part of the steering system. It's used to uphold, yeah? So please, people, the U-bolt. They're used to uphold the leaf spring, keep them together. Please, to ensure they are in good condition. We have what is known as the Pitman arm, drag link, and we have the steering arm. So Pitman arm is part of the steering component of the truck. Pitman arm is the leverage, see it right here? It is a linkage attached to the steering box that converts the angular motion of the sector shaft into the linear motion needed to steer the wheels. The Pitman arm is supported by the sector shaft and supports the drag link or the center link with a ball joint. Pitman arm, see it here? It transmits the motion it receives from the steering box into the drag or center link, causing it to move left or right to turn the wheels in the appropriate motion. People, be aware of these things. Drag link converts the rotary motion from a crank to a second crank or link in a different plane or axis. The term is commonly used in automotive technology for the link in a four-bar steering linkage that converts rotation of a steering arm to a center link and eventually to the tie rod links, which pivot the wheels to be steered. Drag link is used when the steering arm operates in a plane above the other links. People, know these things. Know your parts that allow you to steer the trucks, right? Drag link converts the sweeping arc of the steering arm to the linear motion in the plane of the other steering links. People, be aware of these things. Be aware of this system that we have here. Right? Typically, one end of the drag link is connected via the Pitman arm and the steering gearbox to the steering wheel, providing the connection between the driver and the steering system. The other end is then attached to the vehicle frame by the idler arm. So this is the idler arm, right? Idler arm. Gentle people, know these things. An alternative steering mechanism is a rack and a pinion, the three-bar linkage that eliminates a drag link by directly moving the steering link, right? Rack and pinion, people. Learn these front-end parts, things that is going on. Learn what is going on with the trucks. And to drive in trucks, people, you need to be aware of these things. The length of the drag link can affect the geometry and thus the steering ratio. Severe wear of this part can affect the wheel alignment, such as the toe-in or toe-out settings. Gentle people, know these things. Check the drag link, right? This can drastically affect the handling and stability of the vehicle at speed. So we have to inspect these things. We have to check if these things were effective or whether or not they were defective and you're driving around defective. And that's why the IT officers stop these trucks and check them, right? And where the trucks don't have these things, they issue them an E1 certificate of defects. And then to correct it now, you have to correct all deficiency, you come back and you get an E2 surgical defects remedied. And you have to pay some money at the tax office. I don't know how much you pay, but I know you pay some money. We have to check our tie rod ends, right? They are integral part of the steering system, right? Just as the name suggests, a tie rod ties your vehicle steering rack So the steering arm is attached to the wheel. There are two types of steering system, rack and pinion steering or a recirculating ball or mechanical steering. Yes, man. The rack and pinion steering is a very simple operation. When you turn your steering wheel, a pinion gear, which is attached to your steering shaft, will roll along the steering rack. The steering rack attached to both wheels at the front will move according to how you turn your wheels. And very important that the tie rod ends are in top condition because they are responsible for transmitting the force from the steering rack to the steering arm and the moving of the wheel. The recirculating ball or mechanical steering system is a little more complex than the rack and pinion. The mechanical system includes a gearbox. When you turn the wheel, your steering shaft will set several gears in motion that control the pitman arm. Right? So in the long and short of it, you see, once and that is why persons who drive trucks are known as professional drivers. And that is why they are sought after and they are wanted, because they have to know all of these things. They have to know all of these things to operate a network and to ensure that the truck that they are driving don't become a bomb and take out people and send people to their grave before their time. They have to check these things to ensure that the vehicle they are operating is safe and that the goods that they are carrying are in good condition. They cannot take anything for granted, people. No, people. We cannot take anything for granted. We have to ensure that the front end parts are in good condition, right? We must remember the tie rod ends play a critical role in the steering system, and because if they are inoperable, then the steering system going fail. Motor cars have tie rod too. You have to get them in good condition. Because if you don't have proper tie rods, in your steering system out of work, you won't get yourself into serious problems. You might try steering end up a boneyard, or you might send people to boneyard, right? So just remember that they play a critical role in moving the wheels when you steer or making turn possible, right? So don't take the front end parts for granted. Any sound you hear, yeah, watch this video, take in this video, yeah, man. Gentle people, everybody hurts whenever there's a traffic crash. Over 324 people are hurting at this moment. Over 1 million persons are hurting globally right now as a result of traffic crashes. A lot of needless deaths, a lot of needless injuries, a lot of needless maiming, a lot of needless loss of limbs. Lots of needless deaths, injuries, and crashes, all because of a violation. I have found out, you see, that the book gives you a code, right? And one of the codes that struck me is the one that said, whatever seed a man sow, that's what he shall surely reap. And since dealing with traffic crashes, I've seen where people have sown bad seeds, overtaking around corners. Not only killing off themselves, they're killing off other people. They're killing off their family members. Right? I would like to appeal to persons. This presentation is a different type of presentation. And persons who operate cars and other vehicles may not be able to identify with this presentation. But let me tell you something. Whether or not you drive truck or not, it's good to know these things. Knowledge is power, right? And we want persons who operate commercial vehicles to also pass their driving exam. Because they will be required to do the driving exam too. And we have to cater to everybody, and we are catering for everyone. But one thing we want people to do, go back and look into yourself. Do a self-introspection of yourself. And yes, and look at the good things that you have done on the road network, and give yourself a big up for that. Yeah, man, give yourself a clap. Yes, man, when you big up yourself. And then you look at those bad things that you do. And you see those bad things that you do, you're going to take them, and you're going to change them around and turn them around for good. Yes, man, you can do it. You can do it. We have to do it for our country. We have to do it for our people here. We have to do it. In a race against time, because it looked like 400. It looked like 400. I and I looking down the barrel of 400. I would want that not to happen. I'm looking down it. So people, we still have people being killed in traffic crashes during the curfew hours. And let me say something to you. Let me say something to all of you who are violating the curfew hours. You shouldn't be doing it in the first place. Right? But my God, man, you're violating the curfew hours. You know, screechy, man, screechy. Screechy. Why you have to do shutter driving? Why you have to do hot-head driving? And why you have to do hard-foot driving? You can have to say, the vehicle should not be on the road. So when the investigation is taking place, understand this, that you're going to look at the Disaster Risk Management Act, and we're going to say you are in violation of that act. You should not be on the road. Then we're going to look at the breaches of the Road Traffic Act that you execute. So it's more than one law. It's going to come at you. Because of the seed that you sow a disobedient seed. Gentle people, any seed you sow, you're going to reap it, you know. Just know that. Just know that. Some people call it karma. But we say, any seed you sow, you're going to reap. So you plant a mango seed, you're going to reap a mango tree. We have a lot of mangoes on it. So let us sow good seed this weekend. Let us strive that we have a weekend. Give it 1 weekend, no? Give it 1 weekend. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Friday, zero. Sunday, zero. Saturday, zero. Sunday, zero. Yes. Give it a zero. No? Give it a zero. Give it a zero, no, man? You can't give it a zero. Let us for 1 weekend. Let us for 1 weekend ensure that dialysis don't come for our bodies. Medarest don't come for our bodies. What other one name? Maypen Cemetery don't come for our bodies. What other one name? Number 5 don't come for our body. Pier River don't come for our bodies. Our Medarest don't come for our bodies. Let us drive up on the road at zero, zero, zero. You'd have seen the mitigating traffic crashes. All traffic crashes are preventable. They are preventable. Hello. Do the right thing, people. Do the right thing. Remember, I tell you, you know, Granny never wrong. Granny say, any seed is where you're going to reap. Granny say, every day the bucket go a well, one day the bottom I got drop out. Granny say. Granny D said, Granny Doris said, my granny. Talk about my granny. My granny said that who cannot hear will always feel. But you know what is sad about it? Sometimes these people who don't hear, they make other people feel. That's the sad part about it. Because them family members feel it, and other people who are using the roadway feel it. So we need to cut out this selfishness. The selfish driving on the going on without, you need to stop it, man. You need to stop it. See, people, I see a style. Somebody put on an indicator turn right. The driver way down the road now decides they're going to speed up. And then blow in the top. You're selfish, man. Who teach you that selfish driving? You want that to be edited out of you, man. Edited out of you. The next thing. I may have some serious issues, you know. Yeah, man, I have some serious issues with drivers out there. 4-way stop sign means stop. You come last, you leave last. Hello. You come there at a 4-way stop sign, you see people there, you're supposed to stop. You see this haste that you're in? It is making waste. Hello. It's not helping nothing. It causes crashes, it causes injuries, it causes damages, it causes total wastage of money. Those are you who love Brooke stop sign. You need to cut it out. You see, I need to do that presentation. I need to. I say I'm going to do it, and I'm not doing it. I need to do it. I'm going to do a presentation that tell you only thing I'm going to present on is the amount of fine money for the offense them and the points. That's the only thing the presentation I'm going to talk about. I'm going to do that presentation. And I would like to use this opportunity. So apart from telling the motive what I want from them, I would like to use this opportunity to call upon the JCF to target these four-way intersection and run the tickets on the drivers who violate them. Yeah, man. Do some undercover, JCF. I beg you, peace step, I beg you. Do some undercover, yeah, man, undercover. Undercover operations at these four-way intersection. I am encouraging, Ken Youth here, the second, is encouraging the JCF to do overt and covert operations at four-way intersections. And anybody who break them and violate it, yeah, man, put it on them. Because look here, we have been talking to everybody, you know, nicely. But hear what now? Some of you look like you prefer to hear when your pocket get burned. Look like it's that you want. Now, if that is what you want, you know, man, that is what you will get. We prefer you don't do that, no, but you get that, man. We get it, man. You're working for it. Stop mean stop. Stop don't mean go. And we need to be our brother's keeper. You see, when I see people drive, they tell me a lot about you, you know. First question I ask, you know, who teach you? Who train you? Who teach you? You never learn around the breakfast and the lunch table and the dinner table to have courtesy and manners. You never learn that. And if you learn it, why you come out on the road and violating what your parents taught you? Hello! Let us remember the nuggets of wisdom that our parents taught us. And let us stop betraying our parents on the road network by driving bad and by being indisciplined. Hello. Give us zero this weekend. Tell your friends across Jamaica, across all the 14 parishes, to give us zero. As if I come back Monday, I hear some people that, you know, I get cross. Make it cross. We cannot be killing off ourselves on the network. We cannot be killing off people on the network. We cannot be using our vehicles as weapons of mass destruction. And passengers, you have a role to play. Stop boost up drivers. Stop boost up drivers to speed. Stop boost up drivers to be press a foot. Stop it, man. That's all I have to say for this weekend. God bless you all. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. We'll see you next week again with another presentation.